Welcome to this video where I'm going to step through two concepts which I think should be mandatory knowledge for any solutions architect. And for anyone else working in IT, these are also really useful. First, we have recovery point objective known as RPO and recovery time objective known as RTO. Generally, if you're a solutions architect helping a client, they will give you their required values for both of these. In some cases, you might need to work with key stakeholders within the business to determine appropriate values. In either case, if you get them wrong, it can have a massive negative consequence to a business. Let's jump in and get started, and we're going to start by stepping through recovery point objective, or RPO. Recovery point objective, or RPO, is something that's generally expressed in minutes or hours. And to help illustrate this, let's take a given 24-hour period. It starts on the left at midday, moves through midnight in the middle, and finishes at 12 midday on the following day on the right. I want you to consider an animal rescue business who have animals arriving to be fostered 24/7, 365. They have intake vet exams and data is stored within on-premises systems which need to be referred to constantly throughout the day. At a certain point in time, let's say 2 a.m, we have a server failure. And for this example, let's assume this is a single server which stores all of the data for the organisation and they have no redundancy. Now, this is a terrible situation, but it's all too common for cash-strapped charities. So remember, donate to your local animal rescue centre. RPO is defined as the maximum amount of data, and this is generally expressed in time, that can be lost during a disaster recovery situation before that loss will exceed what the organisation can tolerate. If an organisation tells you that they have an RPO of 6 hours, it means the organisation cannot tolerate more than 6 hours of data loss when recovering from a disaster, like this server failure. Now, different organisations will have different RPO values. Banks, logically, will be able to tolerate almost no data loss because they deal with customer money, whereas an online store might be able to tolerate some data loss as they can, in theory, recreate orders in other ways. Understanding how data can be lost during disaster recovery scenarios is key to understanding how to implement a given RPO requirement. Let's consider this scenario that every 6 hours, starting at 3 p.m. on day one, the business takes a full backup of the server which has failed. So normally we have a backup at 3 p.m, one at 9 p.m, one at 3 a.m, and one at 9 a.m. So 4 backups every 24-hour period split by 6 hours. In order to recover data from the failed server, we need to restore a backup. Ideally, assuming that we have no failures, it will be from the most recent backup. Now, successful backups are known as recovery points. In the case of full backups, each successful backup is one recovery point. If you use full backups and incremental backups, it's possible that to restore a single incremental backup, i.e. to use that one recovery point, you'll need the most recent full backup and every incremental backup between that full and the most recent okay incremental backup. So it's possible that a recovery point will need more than one backup. With this scenario, so the server failure at 2 a.m, the data loss would be the time between 2 a.m. and the most recent recovery point, in this case, 9 p.m. the previous day. So this represents 5 hours of lost data. If the failure occurred right after the 9 p.m. backup had finished, we'd have almost no data loss. If the failure occurred 1 hour later at 3 a.m, we would have 6 hours of data loss. Now, the maximum loss of data for this type of scenario is the time between 2 successful backups. In our case, because backups occur every 6 hours, then data loss could be a minimum of 0 if the server failure occurred right after the first backup finished, or a maximum of 6 hours if the server failure occurred right before the next scheduled backup. So when an organisation informs you that they have a requirement for an RPO of 6 hours, they're telling you that they can only tolerate a maximum of 6 hours hours of data loss in a disaster scenario. And as a general rule, this means that you need to make sure that backups occur as often or more often than the RPO value provided by the organization. An RPO of 6 hours means at minimum a backup every 6 hours. But to cope with random backup failure, generally you'll want to make sure backups occur more frequently than required. So in this example, maybe once every 3 hours or maybe even once an hour. Lower RPOs generally require more frequent backups, which historically has resulted in higher cost for backup systems, both in terms of media, but also licensing, management overhead, and other associated processes. So RPO is a value which is generally given to you by an organization, or you might have to work with an organization to identify an appropriate value, and it states how much maximum loss of data in time the business can tolerate. Different businesses will have different RPOs, and sometimes even different RPOs for different systems within a single organization. A bank might have super low RPOs for its financial systems, but it might tolerate a much higher one for its website. If data changes less frequently, if the system is less important, then higher RPO values are easier to tolerate for a business. Now let's move on and cover recovery time objective, or RTO. To explain RTO, we're going to use the same example of a 24-hour period starting at midday on one day, moving through that day with midnight in the middle, and then moving to midday the following day on the right. For this example, though, I've moved the server failure to 10 p.m. on day one, and the most recent backup was 9 p.m., so 1 hour before the failure. As you know now, this means assuming the backup is working, i.e. it's a valid recovery point, that the data loss will be 1 hour, the time between the 9 p.m. backup and the 10 p.m. server failure. RTO, or recovery time objective, simply put, is the maximum tolerable length of time that a system can be down after a failure or disaster occurs. Now, once again, just as with RPO, this value is something that a business will give you as a directive, or alternatively, it's something that you'll work with a business on to determine a suitable value. Also, just as with RPOs, different businesses will have different RTOs. A bank will have a much lower RTO for its banking systems than a cafe for its website. And an organization will generally have different RTOs for its different systems. Critical systems will have low RTOs, and less important systems can potentially have higher RTOs. Now, looking at the RTO definition in a different way, if the animal rescue business had an RTO of 13 hours, it would mean that for a server failure which occurred at 10 p.m, the IT operations team would have as a maximum until 11 a.m. the following day to fully restore the system to an operational state. Now, something which is really important that I need you to understand, and this isn't always obvious, especially if you haven't worked on or with a service desk before. Recovery time of a system begins at the moment of the failure. That's when the clock starts ticking, and it ends not when the issue is fixed, but when the system is handed back to the business in a fully tested state. So in this example, the clock starts at 10 p.m, and to meet an RTO of 13 hours, the server needs to be running again, fully working, by 11 a.m. the following day. So you might ask why I'm stressing this point. Well, RTO isn't just about technical things. The biggest impacts on RTOs are things which, as a technical person, you might not always identify. I want to step through some considerations which might impact the ability of this animal rescue's operation team to meet this 13-hour RTO directive. The first thing which might not be immediately obvious is that to recover a system, you need to know that that system has failed. If the failure occurs at 10 p.m, while the recovery time starts at that point, the ability to recover only really starts when you're made aware that the system has failed. So how long until the operations team know that there is an issue? Is there monitoring in place on this service? Is it reliable? Because too many false positives will have people ignoring outage notifications. How will the monitoring system notify staff? Will it wake staff who are sleeping? Will it be the correct staff who are empowered to begin a recovery process? This is the real starting point to any recovery process, and it often adds lag onto the start of the process. Even with major internet applications that I use, it's not uncommon for outages to occur and then take a further 15 to 30 minutes before the vendor is actively aware and investigating the fault. Now, don't underestimate the importance of effective monitoring and notification systems. Beyond that, make sure that you've planned and configured these processes in advance. Waking up a junior operations person who has no ability to make decisions or no ability to wake up senior staff members is useless in this scenario. Best case, this part of the process takes some time, so make sure that it's built into your planning. Now let's move on and assume that we do have somebody in the ops team who can begin the process. Well, step number two is going to be to investigate the issue. It might be something which is fixable quickly, or it might be that a server is literally on fire. Somebody needs to take the time to make the final decision to perform a restore if required, and again, this will take some time. Moving on, if we assume that we are going to do a restore, we need to focus on the backup system. What type of backups do we have? Some take longer to restore versus others. If it's a tape backup system, where are the tapes? Where is the tape drive or the loader? Who needs to restore it? Do they need to be in a specific physical location? How does the restore happen? Is there a documented process? And is the person or one of the people who can perform the restore available and awake? All of these are critical in your ability to begin the restore process, and they all take time. Now, this type of disaster recovery scenario, if you don't have a documented and tested process, this can also be really stressful. And a stressful situation late at night, without your team around you, this is when mistakes happen. But let's assume that we have a working backup system, we know where the backup media is, and we have that and somebody who can operate the restore. The next step is where we're restoring to. The server we had has had a major failure or might literally be on fire. Did you think about this in advance? These choices, so what are we restoring on? Do we have a spare? Do we need to order another server? Are we using physical or virtual servers? Or are we even forced to use a second disaster recovery site, because not only is the server on fire, but also is the server room. Many people miss these elements when thinking about RTO, but these are the things which really matter. A badly documented process to restore servers or a slow notification system might add additional hours, but having to order new server hardware could add days to a recovery time. Then finally, if all goes well, so the restore has completed, the operations team thinks the service is back up and running, but then there needs to be time allocated for business testing, user testing, and final handover. This isn't quick and has to be done before you consider recovery to be complete. This entire process, end to end, is what recovery is. And so if a business has a 13-hour RTO, you need to make sure that all of this process in its entirety fits into that 13 hours. So that's what RTO is, a value given to you by a business or something that you help a business identify. It's the maximum tolerable time to recover a system in the event that a disaster occurs. It's the end-to-end process, so this includes fault identification, restoration, and final testing and handover. So it's really important that when you're planning the recovery process for a system and you're given an RTO value by the business, that you make sure that you have time to perform all of these individual steps. Now let's quickly summarize what we've learned before we finish this video. So RPO is how much data, the maximum data expressed in time that a business can lose. So this is an amount of data expressed in time that beyond which it's not tolerable to the business. So worst case, this is the time between successful backups. In general, to implement more and more demanding RPO directives, you need more frequent backups. This means more cost, but it does result in a lower RPO. So when you see RPO, think maximum data loss. RTO, or recovery time objective, is a directive from the business which is a maximum restore time that that business can tolerate. And this is end to end from identification through to final testing and handover. So this can be reduced by effective planning, monitoring, notification, formal processes, spare hardware, training, and more efficient systems such as virtual machines or AWS. So RTO is the maximum time from when a failure occurs through to when the business will need that system back up and running in an operational state. And by thinking about this in advance, you can make your recovery process more efficient and meet more demanding RTOs from a business. Now, different businesses and different systems within businesses will have different RPO and RTO values. Generally, the more critical a system is, the lower and thus more demanding the RPO and RTO values will be. For non-critical systems, a business is usually more willing to tolerate higher and so less demanding RPO and RTO values, because generally what you're looking for is a Goldilocks point where you're as close to the true business requirements as possible. Now, as a solutions architect, it's often the case that a business isn't aware of appropriate RPO and RTO values, and so one of the core duties when designing new system implementations is to work with the business and understand which systems are critical and which can tolerate more data loss or recovery outages. And by appropriately designing systems to match the true business requirements, you can deliver a system which meets those requirements in a cost-effective way. Now, at this point, that's everything I wanted to cover about RPO and RTO at a high level. If you're doing one of my AWS courses, as you're going through the course, consider how you think the products and services being discussed would affect the RPO and RTOs of systems designed utilizing those products. And if appropriate, I'll be discussing exactly how features of those products can influence RPO and RTO values. At this point, though, that's everything I wanted to cover in this video. Thanks for watching. Go ahead and complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.